This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so welcome you again for Ashmole and GTN class. Okay, so this slide is real important for part two people. These are the all possible numbers from where you can get the questions. All numbers are important. So there are two such slides that have made, and all the knowledge is from this guideline only. So what is the incidence of Hmol? That is 1 in 714. Okay, so this number you have to know. Now a new thing has been added in this guideline, that they have given incidence because this Hmol is more common in extremes of age. So they have given these two numbers of incidence also. So you can get question from this as well. So if it is 15 years of age, then incidence, 1 in 500 pregnancies. And if it is more 50 years of age patient, then incidence will be 1 in 8. So all these numbers are important. And after live birth, incidence is very less, but yes, it is still 1 in 50,000. Okay. Now some whenever the miscarriage is there, and they are doing surgical treatment for that, so most of the time means all the time they sent this for histopathology. Okay, and in some of those histopathology of miscarriages after medical or surgical treatment is done, so when they look under the microscope, so in 2.7% of the cases, they can find unrecognized mole. Okay, so this number is new in this guideline. This has also become important for SPA. Now, after therapeutic abortion, usually if the patient is coming for abortion, that means pregnancy is going well. So, but they don't want pregnancy, therefore they're coming up for abortion. So most of the time, baby is okay when the patient is coming for abortion. So risk of GTN after therapeutic abortion, it is 1 in 20,000. Okay, all these numbers are new in this guideline. Now, this is a very famous question. It keeps on coming. Though they have changed percentage. So in complete mole, 75 to 80% it will occur from the duplication of single sperm. And 20 to 25, it will be dispermic fertilization of an empty ovum. Previously, whatever the SBAs we used to do, this number was 90 and 10, okay? But this percentage has been changed in this guideline. So it is important, and you have to remember this, okay? This is in case of complete mole. In case of partial mole, 90% will have triploid origin. That means they will carry two sets of paternal chromosome. That is not, this number is same in last SBS. This number is used to be same. This number has changed. Okay. Now twin with mole, there are few percentages you can get question from. So it could be like early fetal loss. It occurs in 40%. Preeclampsia 20% and preterm labor in twin with mole, it occurs in 36% of the patients. Okay, so these are the few new numbers in this guideline. Only this number one, that is incident in live birth, 1 in 714. Only this number is from old guideline. It is the same. Rest all numbers they have added new in this guideline. So they becomes now real important. Now, chemotherapy rate, this number has also been changed from previous guidelines. So you will be, you may be getting question from this. And this number is important for part three also, because they have all in the role player stations also, they have to use this number. So what will be the chemotherapy required rate of chemotherapy? For partial molar pregnancy, it is 0.5 to 1%. Okay, this number you have to remember. Now this number has changed. After complete molar pregnancy, in previous guideline it was 15%, though it is near to that only. Now they have changed it to 13 to 16%. So this number has changed from the previous guideline. So you have to remember this. Then what is the cure rate? This is also newly added to this guideline. There is a FIGO scoring that we already know, and if the score is less than 6, then cure rate will be 100%, okay? But if the score is more than 6, then cure rate will be 94%. And if somebody has score of 14, so death will occur in 4 weeks, okay? So all these are new things that has been added. So it is worthwhile, you have to remember these numbers. Now, new guideline, this placental site trophoblastic tumor and epithelioid trophoblastic tumor, they have added few things about that, and this is important. So the incidence of these two tumors is 0.2%, okay? And what the guideline writes, if diagnosis occur within 48 months, then chances of getting treated and survival are good. But if they have not given that number, how much the chances of survival if diagnosis occur within 48 months. But this number they have given. If diagnosis of PSTT or ETT, it occurs after 48 months, so chances of death will be 100%, okay? This number may be important. Now, sometimes atypical placental nodule is there, okay? Where at a local site, trophoblastic hyperplasia, but some atypical cells are there. So this is, so there could be typical placental nodule where it only hyperplasia of trophoblasts are there, and there could be some atypical placental nodules. So if it is there, then why we are worried about it? Because in atypical placental nodules, 10 to 15% chances that it may turn up into cancer, okay? And type of cancer what will occur will be PSTT and ETT. This is also newly added number. Now recurrence will occur 1%. Okay, this number has, they have also changed. Previously it was 1 in 80, but in new guideline they write recurrence 1%. Okay, and congenital anomaly rate general. When this patient has not taken any kind of chemotherapy, then general congenital anomaly rate was 1.8. So this is new number to me as well, because previously I knew it was 3%, but this guideline writes it as 1.8. Okay. Now this is also a new number. So if the chemotherapy, if patient has taken chemotherapy, what will be the chance of future pregnancy? Okay. So it is 80%. So this is a new number that has been added to this guideline. So these were two number slides that were important for part two people. Now, also they have changed in the guideline. So what is GTD and what is GTN? So GTD is a spectrum, you know, it will span out the, or it will involve for pre-malignant conditions of complete mole, partial mole, to through the malignant condition also, that will be invasive mole, choriocarcinoma, PSTT, and ETT. Okay, so the everything is coming from pre-malignant to this malignant condition in GTD. Okay, so this is from the new guideline. Previously, cancer things were in GTN, but in this guideline they have changed this. So they have made GTD as a spectrum. So it will span from pre-malignant condition, and it will involve all this malignant conditions also. Okay. Now apart from atypical placental side nodule, its malignant potential according to this guideline they don't know, but 10 to 15% chances of turn up into cancer is there. Now GTN, again, if any treatment has been given for GTD and there is a persistence even after the prior treatment, that usually will be picked on the follow-up when the SCG will be permanent persistently high. So this condition they will call as a GTN. Okay, so this has been changed in their definition. Previously it was not like that, and for GTN, as they are diagnosing it as a persistence elevation of HCG after primary treatment of GTD. So what they say for its diagnosis, no histological confirmation is required. Okay, on the basis of this only, they will say it is in GTN. So is the thing clear? They have changed this classification or definitions for GTD and GTN. Is the thing clear for all you people?
Yes, ma'am. It's clear, ma'am.
Okay. Now, this is not a new thing. We already know. So in complete mole, usually a single sperm will fertilize an empty ovum. Then there will be duplication. Okay. So it occurs according to this guideline in 75% to 80%. And sometime there is a dyspermic classification. Percentages, how much is there? Though changes there, I have already explained. And in partial mole, there will be two sperm, and they will fertilize with the egg with the genetic material. Okay, here they are fertilizing with the empty ovum, but here they are fertilizing with the two sperm fertilizing with a single ovum with the genetic material. So always three set of chromosome will be there. So there will be always a triploid presentation. Triploid presentation occur in 90%. Rest 10%, it would be tetraploid or other chromosome sets may be there. Okay, this is simple thing, you know this. Now you will get question from this, so you have to remember this table. Know this table, and this table is again it's from your strategy. So now what will be the origin? Origin we have already discussed. Now what is the prevalence? This number you can get question from. So complete mole prevalence is 1 per 1,000 pregnancy, and partial mole it is 3 per 1,000 pregnancy. Okay, fetal tissue not present in complete mole, we already know, but in partial mole fetal tissue will be present, but placenta will have trophoblastic hyperplasia also. Now histology you have to know, because from H mole histology also you get a number of question. So in complete mole, usually it is trophoblastic hyperplasia and diffuse villous head drops. Okay, so almost whole of the placenta, you will find that every part of it is involved. Therefore, it gives typical snowstorm appearance. And there will be a patient will say, you know, she's like passing whitish grape-like structure. Okay. So this usually happens in H mole. Now in partial mole, as baby formation is also there, so usually it gives picture of threatened miscarriage, okay, because baby part will also be there. So you have to know this histopathology, because questions you also comes from here as well. So there will be focal changes in the placenta, okay, so focal villous head drops may be there. And focal trophoblastic hyperplasia can be there. And also it do have a trophoblastic pseudocalcin inclusions. This you have to remember, because in questions, they sometimes give this, and this will be a key word, you know. Then identifiable fetal tissue is also there. Now, sometimes you're not able to find out whether it is a complete mole or partial mole. Then they use immunohistochemistry techniques. So in complete mole, P57 is not expressed, and because no maternal gene tissue, no maternal genetic information is not there in complete mole, therefore P57 is not expressed. But in partial mole, this will be expressed. Okay, so in the new guideline, they have also included this number. Now, few important points. So only one line I have to explain here. This is from strategy. Rest part is, you know, everything you know, and it will be in the guideline. Risk of recurrence after 1 mole and 2 mole. So after 1 mole, risk of recurrence, we already know, we have just read it is 1%. But if 2 moles are there, and then how much will be the risk of recurrence? So it will be 20%. Okay, so to know this number, I have just put this slide. Now, if the mole has been diagnosed, so what will be the investigation has to be sent? So this you have to know, part two people also, but in part three it is important because they will ask, you know, the question from here. So how will you investigate the case? And these are the investigation you have to send. And this is from the strategist, according to strategy. So you have to send full blood count, blood group and RH. Then you have to send HCG. Okay, then you have to arrange for a pelvic ultrasound. And again, diagnosis will be required from the HPE. Then if the HPE confirms molar pregnancy, then the registration for surveillance will be required. So this whole thing you have to say in part three exam. What are the investigation? How would you investigate the case? Now this again, snowstorm appearance. You may get this scan picture, okay, in exam. So you at least you have to know the classical presentation of snowstorm. In part three station, they have given this ultrasound and they have never mentioned whether this patient has mole. So you have to know the ultrasound presentation of this. And it is just for a knowledge. In a twin pregnancy, you can see one, this is a complete mole. So there is a placental trophoblastic hyperplasia you can see, and this is the normal placenta. Okay, this picture I have taken from strategy just for, you know, to have a visualization, but it is not important for exam purpose at all. Now, how will you manage, what will be the management options? So, you know, it will be surgical, it could be medical, it could be hysterectomy, and sometime there would be required from uterine, second time uterine evacuation. Okay, so this is important mostly in answering part three, because they are, you have to, you know, give answer from here. So in surgical, usually what they are saying, if the complete mole is there, then suction evacuation can be done. And so suction catheter of less than 12 mm is usually sufficient to evacuate it. But if the partial mole is there, and in that particular situation, as the fetal parts are formed in partial mole, so they will be, it will limit use of suction or curettage. So there could be possibility of medical termination, or medical method will be required for to terminate those kind of pregnancies. So you will find in both part two and part three, you will find this question that then you have to explain to this role player, or you have to answer the question that what will be the method for them. Okay, so if you're getting complete mole, so answer will be going for suction and curettage. And if you are getting partial mole, then and if the pregnancy is big, then consideration for medical termination or medical removal of pregnancy will be the answer. Okay, so this way you have to judge it. Now again, same thing, medical termination. So usually we avoid, if we have a choice to make, so we'll never allow a molar pregnancy medically. Why? Because there is a theoretic risk of trophoblastic embolization during uterine contraction. Okay, so but in case of partial mole, if the fetal parts are big, then this is the only option left. In rare circumstances, hysterectomy will be an option. So it will be elective if a patient has GTN and she doesn't want any fertility. And sometime if too much of bleeding is there, so it could be emergency also. And a very important thing to remember that can come in the exam, if the hysterectomy is come, okay, they will ask a question, does this patient require any trophoblastic center registration or follow-up? So your answer will be yes, okay? Even after they have removed the source from where the trophoblastic hyperplasia is there, they have removed uterus, but still extra uterine trophoblastic metastasis may be there, so follow-up is must. So this part is important for both two and three people. Now, second uterine evacuation, usually they avoid it because there is a risk of infection, hemorrhage, and uterine perforation. But if in some of the situation, it is required, so it has to be done under the guidance of trophoblastic monitoring center. And also it has to be done by the senior gynecologist, okay? So this is important for part three people, because you have to give them your examiner answer. So what will be the methods or what will be the options for management for this? So you have to give all options. And for part two, people, you may get questions from anywhere. And all this knowledge is from strategy. Now follow up HCG estimations. So usually you already know in the UK, when the molar pregnancy is confirmed after evacuation, histopathology will the tissue will be sent for histopathology. And once the tissue histopathology comes back, then they are usually registered to trophoblastic screening center. In UK, there are three centers are there. So in two of them, treatment and follow-up is done, and one of them only follow-up is done. Okay, so it is not important to know the name of them, but yes, there are three centers. Okay, so this protocol is followed there. They will do two times in a week serum or urine sample until it comes normal. Okay, so this is the protocol they follow. Now, once it is normalized, usually that occurs within 56 days. So then they will do it. They will follow monthly for 6 months. And if the regression takes more than that time, so they would follow from the day when the normalization of HCG comes for 6 months. Okay. So this is the previous, from the previous guideline. Now, in this new guideline update, to 2020, what is the update has been done? So this is important to know. So this part, okay, so it comes normal in 56 days and you have to follow this patient for 6 months from the date when it comes normal. Okay, so this part is same, but this they have said now this is the follow-up for complete molar pregnancy. Okay, now this new thing they have added in this guideline, that for partial molar pregnancy, once HCG has come back to normal, so on two samples, okay, so, the follow-up will be done for the two normal samples only. So this is a new update in this guideline. Previously, they never mentioned, what kind of follow-up for complete molar pregnancy or partial molar pregnancy, but in this new guideline, they have changed. So it is important for you to know. So because this partial molar follow-up they have changed, so there is a chances you will get question from here. Okay, apart from this, what they are saying, woman who has not received any chemotherapy, okay, no longer they have to measure in subsequent pregnancy. In last guideline, what they used to say, whenever they have future pregnancy, so they have to every time they have to follow with the beta HCG levels after 6 to 8 weeks of pregnancy. Okay, but in this guideline they have removed this. Okay, and why they have removed? So what their research has shown, that incidence of GTD in subsequent pregnancy is very low, that is 1 in 4,000. Okay, so it is so less incidence, so therefore they have removed this a routine measurement of beta HCG in any other previous subsequent pregnancy event. So this has been update about the follow-up in this new guideline. Is this clear?
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, in case of partial molar pregnancy, they have mentioned that HCG has returned to normal on two samples at least of 4 weeks apart. So there is no limitation up to 6 months, ma'am. It could be more than 6 months also. We have to check the samples until they are normal with at least 4 weeks apart of two samples.
Yes. So once it has come normal, okay, then they will do two samples 4 weeks apart. After that, they will stop it.
So, madam, it is not limited to 6 months. Even it could be more than 6 months in partial molar pregnancy then.
Okay. So, usually, if it is only partial or complete mole, it will come back within 56 days.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Within 8, it usually comes back normal. But
yes,
if it is not coming normal, so it is going towards GTN then. Are you getting?
That's what
It is then not a partial mole.
Okay, madam. So when we have to make it as a mark to go for chemotherapy or to evaluate the GTN, madam, in case of partial molar pregnancy, then?
Okay, so what are the indications when you will have an suspicion? That I will show in some upcoming slide. Just wait for that. You will, I think your query will be clear. Okay, so these are the updates. So complete mole, it is the same. For partial molar pregnancy, they have changed it. So once it has come back to normal on two samples 4 week apart, so they will stop then follow up. Okay, and in future pregnancy event, if there is no treatment for chemotherapy has been done, so no longer requirement of future in upcoming pregnancy events. Okay, so this is the update. Update for follow up. Okay, now what are the risk factor for persistent GTD or GTN after normal evacuation? So if the, now this slide will answer your query. So if pre-evacuation level is very high, more than 1 lakh, if pre-evacuation uterine size is more than 20 weeks and HMOL is associated with thecal uterine cyst also, if they are more than 6 centimeter, age is more than 40, repeat molar pregnancy, and associated complication, hyperthyroidism or preeclampsia, or any evidence you have already know that previous trophoblastic embolization is there. So these are the few features. So, or these are the risk factor that for developing persistent GTD or GTN after molar uterine evacuation. Some question may come, but you have to know for part two, three people also it is important because it can be asked in the in your Viva exams. Okay. Now, what are the indications of chemotherapy? So now, if there is a platelet or rising HCG concentration, so this is the most common indication. So during your follow up, HCG is not coming down. Okay, it is keep on rising. So this is the it is not rising, but it is plateaued or it maintains a higher level. So these are the indication for chemotherapy. If any evidence of heavy vaginal bleeding or gastrointestinal disease, like any spread to liver or anything is there, or intraperitoneal hemorrhage, if histological diagnosis of choriocarcinoma, if metastasis in brain, liver, gastrointestinal tract or lung, and if HCG concentration more than 20,000 times 4 weeks apart, and if it is raised concentration of HCG even 6 months after evacuation, then these are the indication for chemotherapy. Usually, no need to remember everything from here, though this slide is from strategy. You just need to have an idea what could be the what are the risk factor. So this will give you what are the risk factor for GTD or GTN, and this will give you an idea what are the indications for chemotherapy. Okay, this you have to know. And now the things would be clear to someone who was asking question. So if any risk factor is there for this persistent GTN, whether it is after complete mole or partial mole, so you will get to know when the follow-up is done. Okay, so if any evidence of GTN is coming, HCG level will not come back to normal. Okay, so there will be very high concentration of HCG. So in case of, therefore, but in partial molar pregnancy, the chances are less. Therefore, they have changed this in guideline because they don't want to do unnecessary investigations. They are very cost effective people. So in partial mole, therefore, once it comes back to normal, they have limited to only two normal follow-ups 4 weeks apart. Now it is clear, someone was asking.
Yes, ma'am, clear, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so a few things you have to know. I have not put it so much because sometime they usually give histology also in that course exam. So you have to know typical histological features. Okay, so choriocarcinoma is highly malignant. Everybody knows this. It has a vascular spread. so it spreads very fast. Its incidence is 1 in 50,000 pregnancy. So this number you have to remember, because you can get this in a question. Now it this appear, this is the this is will be the appearance of the uterus inside if they cut it down after hysterectomy, doing hysterectomy in the specimen. So it will appear as a soft purple hemorrhagic mass. So it is a soft purple hemorrhagic mass, because sometime in questions you will get like a uterus on the specimen, this was there. So what could be the diagnosis? So diagnostic questions, they do come in the exam. So it is important you to know. So I have put this picture for the visual memory. Now microscopically, what will be there? There will be abnormal trophoblastic hyperplasia. There will be absence of chorionic villi. Okay, so this part you have to remember. Though it is it is from placenta, okay, everything is coming from the placenta only, but in choriocarcinoma there will be absence of chorionic villi. So usually they give this in the exam, so you have to know this. Hemorrhage and necrotic area would be there, and there will be invasion into myometrium and venous sinuses. This part everybody knows, because in cancer all these things do happen. What you have to remember, there will be no maintenance of chorionic villi. Okay, so so it is important. So this could be the buzzword, soft purple hemorrhagic mass and absence of chorionic villi. And so that will help you in answering your question. Metastasis is usually by vascular spread. So clinical presentation of choriocarcinoma will be bleeding, and because it present as a metastasis, most of the time when the patient comes to us it is late. So excision biopsy from the metastasis can be done for histological diagnosis, but sometimes biopsy is not possible. Okay, in that particular situation diagnosis is made on the clinical history, FIGO scoring is done, and the treatment will be done accordingly. So if choriocarcinoma is there, and if the metastasis is on a place like it is lung metastasis, liver metastasis, you are not in a position to take biopsy for histological diagnosis, then no need to do that. Treatment can be done on the FIGO scoring. So this is a good thing that you have to remember. Now a PSTT, placental site trophoblastic tumor. This few things has been added in this guideline about this tumor, and also sometime I have seen questions, and question do come about the histology. Okay, few things come from this that I'll be telling you. PSTT is usually it is a tumor of mononuclear intermediate trophoblast. Okay, questions come from this line, mononuclear intermediate trophoblast. So you have to remember this. So they usually present infiltrating in the form of sheets in the myometrial fibers. So usually what is the type of trophoblast? So it is intermediate trophoblast. This question do come. Then a few peculiar things are there about the PSTT. So they produce HCG in very small amounts. Okay, and usually because they produce very less amount of HCG, so whenever the follow-up is done, so HCG value will be less, but if they do and scan, if they look for the volume of disease, so it will be high, because they are not producing the good amount of HCG. So on the follow-up, it becomes difficult to detect. Okay, apart from this, it has less vascular invasion. Why? Because PSTT, they spread by lymphatic route. Okay, this is difference in choriocarcinoma and PSTT. So that part you have to know. And these are like less sensitive to chemotherapy. All other tumors, they are sensitive to chemotherapy. So they will be doing like single agent or multiple agent. But PSTT, as they are not sensitive, so usually hysterectomy or surgical treatment would be an option. Again, HCG is not reliable marker for this kind of tumors, because they are not producing in a large amount. So clinical follow for long term will be required. So this much information about PSTT is required. Rest information, what is required, will be from the guideline. Invasive mole, only few things are required. So in invasive mole, usually myometrial invasion is there. Okay, it can occur in 10% of H moles. So this 10% number, minimum one number you can remember. Okay, apart from this, either diagnosis will, how they will be diagnosed. So you have put a patient on follow-up, and on the follow-up, HCG level will not come down. So that means you are going towards, there could be possibility of invasive mole. And so usually, if the histological diagnosis is not possible, consideration for clinical diagnosis and FIGO scoring, and then chemotherapy will be done. Okay. So that's all I have to say. This is a FIGO scoring. This you have to remember. Why it is important? Because it will help in answering question. Even in part three, when the station came, so you have to calculate FIGO even in the part three also, in that particular station. So FIGO you have to remember. Now few things, many questions come from this UK MAC also. So this is from like FSRH guideline. So now you can see, for any other contraception except intrauterine, every time these are category one. Okay, so whether HCG was undetectable, whether it was decreasing, or whether it was persistently high, then also though all other contraceptive, it was category one. For only intrauterine, that is IUCD, LNG, IUS, if it is decreasing, then it is category three, and if it is high, then it is category four. Okay, so this part you have to remember, because you will get a number of questions from here. Even this new guideline also says, whatever the hormones you are giving, it is according to the like this guideline. So this part you have to remember. So any question? Any one of you have got any question? Okay, so if you have got no question, then we can do guideline. Okay, so Junaitha, you can now volunteer.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so first is the definition of GTD. So now this I have already explained what is GTD. So it is group of disorders from pre-malignant to that will include partial and mole. To malignant, okay, invasive mole, choriocarcinoma, and PSTT. So this is the all GTD, and if they are not coming back to normal, then it will set as a GTN. So this definition you have to remember. Okay, now this is very important. Now you tell me, incomplete molar pregnancy, though we have done this, but this will be revision. Incomplete molar pregnancy, so how much percentage will be the duplication of a single spot?
Hello, this 75% ma'am.
Hello, Dr. Kieta.
Yes,
please explain me again GTD and GTN. I cannot get the point.
Okay, so in GTD, okay, all of you mute yourself. GTD consists of complete range of lesions from pre-malignant, that is complete to partial mole, and also it includes malignant lesions such as invasive mole, choriocarcinoma, PSTT, and ETT. Okay, so all of these things are included in GTD. So if the definition of GTD comes, so this will, they will include everything. But when it will be GTN, whenever all these conditions, they are put on follow-up, And on the follow-up, if there is a permanent elevation of HCG, this condition will be GTN. And for GTN only, HCG monitoring, they will be able to diagnose it. Histological confirmation is not required for that also. Okay, so this has been changed the definition. Previously, it was not there. Clear?
Here, one thing given, the persistence of GTD after primary treatment. What is the meaning of primary treatment here? Because that in molar pregnancy, molar pregnancy, we do suction evacuation. It is the primary treatment. But in case of choriocarcinoma, yes, our first choice is chemotherapy. So chemotherapy is also primary treatment here. And no, we do suction. Please clarify.
Okay. So primary treatment will be like whatever the treatment you have given before. Usually, you will primary treatment. Like initially, if the diagnosis of H mole or partial mole is there, then you will do, it will be done surgical evacuation or it will be done medical. Yeah. But if like initial diagnosis, first day diagnosis is a choriocarcinoma, then primary treatment will be chemotherapy. But after that also, you will put that on a follow-up.
So we don't know. Choriocarcinoma is a malignancy, na? We don't know this. So the previous thing. The choriocarcinoma, then it's malignant. It is not GTD, it is GTN. Because we don't know. Choriocarcinoma is a persistent. Now we need long-term treatment here.
Yes. Okay. So, so malignant, if it is a malignant condition also, then also it is included under the GTD spectrum. Only after primary treatment, if it is not coming down, then it will be GTN.
Okay.
So this is the change in the definition.
Okay, I got the point. Thank you.
Okay, so Junaitha, you have to tell me this number and percentage is new. So how many diaspermic fertilization will be there in complete mole?
It is 20 to 25% of diaspermic fertilization.
Yes, very good. And how much will be the
75-80% duplication of the single?
Yes. Okay. So this number is same in partial molar pregnancy. 90% triploid and 10% will be tetraploid or mosaic conceptions. Okay. In partial molar pregnancy, fetus and fetal blood cells are already there. So this we know. So what is the calculated incidence of GTD?
One in 714 live births.
Yes. Okay. Now Asian have higher incidence. Okay. This you may get in a question also. And what will be the incidence? And also, it is more at the extremities of age. So, if the woman is less than 15 years, what will be the incidence?
1 in 500, ma'am. If the age is more than 50 years, it will be 1 in 8 pregnancies, ma'am.
Yes. And what will be in live birth?
Live birth after 1 in 50,000, ma'am.
Okay, so this number we have done in the slide also. This is the revision of the numbers. Now, what will be the most common clinical presentation with which the patient will come to you?
Most common presentation is irregular vaginal bleeding with pregnancy test positive, and there will be supportive evidence of ultrasound pictures, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. So this is a common presentation. This number is newly added in this guideline. So vaginal bleeding is present in how many percentage?
60%, ma'am.
Yes. This number also you can get question. So less common presentation would be hyperemesis. It will be eclampsia. It will be abdominal distension, large thecal luteal cyst. It will be hyperthyroidism, or sometime if a patient is coming with a metastasis. So hemoptysis because of lung involvement, seizures because of brain involvement may be there. Okay. So what will be the, like in complete molar pregnancy, so how it will appear in ultrasound scan?
It is snowstorm appearance, ma'am.
Yes, usually it is a polypoid mass lesion. Yeah, and snowstorm appearance, what we did. So in partial molar pregnancy, as the fetal part is already there, so there will be enlarged pregnancy placenta. So what is the soft marker used to identify partial molar pregnancy?
The cystic phases in the placenta and
You will calculate the dimension.
The ratio of transfers to dimension. The ratio of transfers to anteroposterior will be more than 1 in 1.5.
So this is a soft marker of ultrasound. So that will help in diagnosis of partial molar pregnancy. Okay. And please understand, it is they are not calculating this diameter of a vesicle, but it is of gestational sac. So if you measure transfer, make the ratio of transfers to AP diameter of a gestational sac, so it will be in this ratio, 1 is to 1.5. So this is a soft marker for partial molar pregnancy, and 40% of the molar pregnancy, okay, this number will be correctly identified because of this. Okay, how the definitive diagnosis will be done?
Histological examination.
Yes, so fetal diagnosis will be done after it is looked under the microscope with the histology. So what will be the histological finding in complete molar pregnancy? This we have already discussed. So there will be uniform or complete hydropic changes in villi and trophoblastic proliferation. In partial molar pregnancy, focal changes will be there. Fetal tissue will also be present. And immunohistochemistry, this they have added in the new guideline. So P57, it will be absent in complete mole and it will be present in partial mole. So with this, if they have got any confusion, they will be able to identify difference between the molar or non-molar, complete or partial molar pregnancy. So what will be the method for evacuation
for complete term or partial?
Yeah, P57 will be there in partial mole. Okay, it will be absent in complete mole.
Okay, ma'am.
This is what you were asking.
Yes, ma'am, that P50, actually they given only, it will help in distinguishing between partial and complete mole. But they didn't mention whether which present in partial or complete, they didn't mention, no, ma'am, that's why I asked.
But I showed you in a slide, complete mole, it will be absent,
okay, ma'am.
So what will be the method of choice for complete molar pregnancy?
Suction curettage is there.
Yes, suction curettage. In last guideline, they wrote suction evacuation, but now they have changed to suction curettage. Okay. So this number, you have to remember this. Now, it can be done under ultrasound guidance. So that will help in removal and curettage of maximum of tissue. Now, in partial molar pregnancy, because the size, this we have discussed, partial size of fetal part, sometimes they are big, so suction curettage may not be used, then medical removal will be done. So now you can tell me why they don't want medical treatment for molar pregnancy, why they are preferring surgery? Because,
okay, let me tell you.
So they are not.
I couldn't get the question, ma'am.
Okay, why they want to do treat complete mole surgically? Why they don't want to give medical treatment for complete mole? What is the reason? Okay, I'll tell you. So in medical, usually
complete mole, ma'am.
Yes, but I will tell you reason again. So they prefer surgical method rather than medical method. Why? Because if the medical treatment is given, so there will be uterine contractions, okay? And with this uterine contraction, there is a risk of tumor embolization. And because of this tumor embolization, according to their research, those patients will have 16 times higher requirement for chemotherapy. Okay, therefore, they are using surgical method for complete mole rather than medical method. So they will require, if they are treated medically, 16 times more requirement of chemotherapy will increase. Is this clear? Because you may get question from this number also.
Yes, ma'am, how clear, ma'am?
Yeah.
Hello, I'm sorry, ma'am. Yes. Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am.
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah.
Ma'am, what are the, for the partial, that partial mole, fetal parts, when the fetal parts are deters the use of suction curettage, what is the method of the medical removal, ma'am? What is the,
it will be same what is done for the medical abortions. There is no change in the protocol they have said, okay? Even in the strategy, even in the guide, they have just said medical removal. They have not specified anything. That means it will be same what it is given for medical abortion. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, so this number I have already explained. This you have to remember, you will get question from there. So in complete molar pregnancy, 13 to 16% of the patient will require chemotherapy. In partial mole, it is 0.5 to 1%. Okay, so this you have to know. Then if unrecognized molar pregnancy is there, like you are going to do suction today, and molar all of a sudden you never knew that it is a molar pregnancy, you are doing suction. So what are the complications you may get? Okay, so if it is unrecognized,
so the bleeding.
Yes, because you are not prepared for that. So you will not take precautions. So there will be life-threatening complication may happen if it is unrecognized. There will be bleeding and maybe you will use oxytocin. So all this tumor embolization will be there. So chances of requiring, so if it is unrecognized and you are treating that, or anyone is treating that, so there will be increased risk of life-threatening complications. There could be possibility of more surgical intervention because maybe there will be not complete removal at one go, or increased chances of chemotherapy required will be there. This thing is important in this guideline. Usually, a trophoblastic, there will be D antigen will not be present in a complete molar pregnancy. Therefore, for complete molar pregnancy, NTD is not given usually. But what this guideline says, that diagnosis, whether it is complete mole or partial mole, it will be done with the histology, and histology cannot come back within 72 hours, okay? So, and for practical reasons, NTD prophylaxis can be done for everyone. Okay, so this is an important thing. So they have added this line in this guideline. Previously, it was not there. So if the question comes, now two way the question can come. If it is come, whether it is required for complete mole, then you will say no. Okay, but if they say a patient is sending for this and this, so you have got no diagnosis, only molar pregnancy is there, then in that situation you have to say yes, NTD can be given, because histological confirmation cannot be done within 3 days, and we have to give NTD in 3 days. So this part you have to understand. The question can come in two different ways, okay? So that you have to know in this about the NTD. Okay, now usually for preparation of cervix is done But for the surgical, if it is required for mole, so it will be immediately. Like just prior to surgical evacuation, it can be done. But prolonged, like 3 hours before or 4 hours before, what we put misoprostol, usually that should not be done. Okay, so what they are saying
in that time, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes. Yes,
ma'am.
Yes.
In that time, what we can get, that, ma'am? Meso. For cervical preparation, what we can use, ma'am?
So it can be anything, but it has to be immediate. Okay, what the ripening of cervix is with physical dilator or prostaglandin prior to removal. What they are saying is not associated with risk of GTN. Okay, what they are saying, it is not associated. So anything can be done, but you have to do it immediately. Prolonged, it is not required. Why prolonged it is not done? Because if contraction comes, then there will be risk of tumor embolization. So this immediately is the catchword. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Okay, so about the oxytocin infusions, what they are saying, so if oxytocin infusion prior to removal is not recommended, okay, again, they want to avoid strong contractions and trophoblastic embolization. But if there had been a significant hemorrhage is there, then it can be used, but then in that particular situation you have to keep a balance because of the risk of tumor embolization. So here you will get two kind of scenario. In one kind of scenario, they will give a patient where there is no bleeding, okay, patient is stable and you are taking this patient for surgical management. Answer would be like oxytocin infusion should be avoided. That will be the answer. In another scenario of ESMOL, they will give a patient where there had been a heavy bleeding. Okay, in that particular situation, your answer will change. There could surgical removal will be expedited, and consideration for oxytocin infusion can be done. Okay, so now you have to before you answer, you have to find out if your patient is stable, then you will say no to oxytocin infusion. But if your patient in the scenario is having heavy bleeding or has significant hemorrhage or cardiovascular status showing some like low blood pressure or tachycardia, they are giving you picture of hemorrhagic shock type. In that particular situation, consider you will, this will be the exact, this line will be the answer. Expedition of surgical removal and need for oxytocin has to be balanced or weighed up. Okay. This part I have already explained why they are so much of worried about not using contraction or using oxytocin. Because of contraction, there will be dissemination of the tissue or tumor embolization. Okay, again, what they are saying. So usually repeat surgical evacuation is not indicated, okay, but there are few indications where in mole also they will do repeat surgical evacuation. So what are these conditions? Number one, so if the patient is coming with the hemorrhagic shock or acute hemodynamic compromise and patient has retained products. So patient, if the, for example, if the patient is has come to you with a bleeding and she gives you history that I had a evacuation for molar pregnancy, now she has come with a bleeding and retained products, this is one of the scenario where second time surgical management will be done. This is number one. Number two, if acute compromise is not there, and for any condition, if you think that the surgical management should be done second time, then we have done this before also, that it has to be done in consultation with GTD center. Okay, then if there is no compromise, you have got time, you can take advice from trophoblastic center, and it has to be done with an expert person only. Is the thing clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, and if the bleeding is there, so what could be done? What are the, if you are expediting surgical management, there will be bleeding. So what can be used to avoid bleeding? To reduce bleeding?
Balloon tamponade.
Yes.
Balloon tamponade or uterine artery embolization.
Yes, so they can, it can be done with a balloon tamponade or uterine artery embolization. Now this is newly added in this guideline. So sometime vaginal metastasis is also there. So how the bleeding can be stopped?
By vaginal pack compression.
Yes, so from the pressure, they will put some pressure with the vaginal pack, and this will, this way bleeding can be stopped, stopped from the vaginal metastasis. Usually if the vaginal metastasis is there, it appears as a bluish spots on the vagina. Okay, okay, so what is usually done? So in after all miscarriages, all the pregnancy tissue should be sent for histopathology or not? So what the RCOG says? Okay, you can answer.
Yes, all material to be, all material from medical and surgical management of miscarriage to be sent for histopathology, ma'am.
Yes, so in case of miscarriage, so if the pregnancy is miscarried, okay, so there has to be some reason. So so in UK, all miscarriages, they are usually examined histologically to exclude this trophoblastic neoplasia. Okay, and now if and the patient who are receiving care for miscarriage, usually they have to do urine pregnancy test after 3 weeks. This is also important. Now if the what they are saying, so all the with the all miscarriage, they, it should be sent for histopathology. But if no tissue is sent, okay, so now the there could be one scenario where they will say miscarriage has been done but tissue has not been sent. Then what will be the next choice? So you will answer will be pregnancy test after 3 weeks. So now if it is still positive after 3 weeks, the pregnancy test, then in that condition they will do ultrasound scan to look for the remain pregnancy tissue. And in these conditions where this suction evacuation or any treatment has been done for miscarriage, GTD is unrecognized, so its percentage is 2.7. okay, this number I have put in the slide also. So this is the incidence of unrecognized GTD prior to removal in the is 2.7, or you will find from histopathology specimens incidence of unrecognized GTD is 2.7. so this is newly added number, this may you get in the exam also.
How it is prior to removal, ma'am? By ultrasound, is it mean?
No, like usually when the suction evacuation is done for molar pregnancy, okay, usually scan is done. If it is diagnosed, then you know how to treat it. But sometime it will be only miscarriage on the scan. There will be like no suspicion of any mole. When they sent on the histopathology, then only histopathology slide will show that it is a molar pregnancy. So this will be unrecognized mole prior to removal. Only diagnosis is done after removal under the microscope looking. Is it clear now?
ma'am, it is unrecognized after removal only, no ma'am. We recognize it after removal only, no?
Yes, so it is but basically.
By histopathology.
Yes, it is recognized from the histopathology, but it is not recognized on ultrasound before they remove it. So it is the incidence. You're not diagnosed it before removal. You are diagnosing it after the removal on the histopathology. This is the number.
Okay,
ma'am. I think I got a doubt. If sorry, ma'am, to interrupt. Can I explain her?
Yes, yes.
Actually, see, it is like this. First, you have done you have curated because of the miscarriage. After that, you have not sent for HP. Then you follow up with the beta HCG, urine pregnancy test. Suppose it has not come to normal within 3 weeks, then you will repeat an ultrasound, but you cannot make out still. Then you go for a removal of whatever products are there. So that has to be sent for HPE. So this incidence of GTE that is unrecognized prior to the first removal is 2.7%. But then it gets diagnosed in the second time when you're removing it and sending for HPE. Is that clear? Hello?
No.
No, it
no,
is not.
No, first. No.
It is not first.
It's
or
not
second.
The second one, I think.
No,
yeah.
No, it is not, first or second. No, no, no. It is just not diagnosed before your treatment. And diagnosis has been done after under the microscope. So it is unrecognized before. So this incidence is 2.7. First and second is nothing. I don't think so. It is after first or second. It is not recognized before treatment. Is it clear?
It is recognized after removal. Is it, ma'am?
The removal is the second time. Once the beta HCG has been high for 3 weeks, then you remove the pregnancy tissue, whatever is left, and then you send it for HP, it gets recognized.
No, it is not.
So this is the second follow-up.
No, because in somewhere else in the guideline also same number is there. Okay, so it is not recognized prior if you have done any medical treatment or surgical treatment. So it has been diagnosed after your treatment on the ultrasound on the HP. So this is the number. In previously also same number was there. First time, second time, it is not like linked to that. Is it clear? Just understand this. So we are not able to diagnose when we were doing treatment, either medical or surgical evacuation. We sent histopathology and diagnosis is done on the histopathology. So it was not diagnosed previously. So this number is 2.7%. Is it clear? Because previously also somewhere in the guideline, same number is there.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Now I got it now, ma'am.
Yeah. So because I don't want to scroll this whole guideline down, maybe I will send the screenshot. But it is this way only. It is not first and second. Please don't get confused. Okay. So if patient has come requested for abortion and on ultrasound scan fetal parts are identified, does this tissue required to send for histopathology?
There is no need.
Yes, because if
the fetal parts identified, there is
yes.
No need.
Yeah, if the fetal parts are identified, then there is no need. Okay, so chances of having molar pregnancy will be very less, or it will be 1 in 20,000 only. Okay, so GTD after therapeutic abortion, this number, you know, you may get in the question. So it is 1 in 20,000. Fine. Now another second type of scenario: ultrasound was not done, or they have not mentioned anything, but patient has gone from medical abortion. Now, what will be your recommendation?
Pregnancy, urine pregnancy test after 3 weeks, ma'am.
Yes, because in medical abortion, usually sometime what they do, they just take all the time ultrasound scan is not done. So they will take this medications. Sometimes they are posted also. So they are taking all these medications by themselves. So they have to follow it up to identify, you know, any unrecognized this mole. So because of this, pregnancy test is done after 3 weeks.
Okay, so if this regarding ma'am, this regarding the medical abortion, what regarding miscarriage?
Miscarriage we have already done. All miscarriages they are sending to histopathology. In miscarriage, all miscarriages they are sending to histopathology. In case histopathology was not sent, then pregnancy test has to be done for 3 weeks, after 3 weeks. Okay, so this is in case of miscarriage. In cases of abortion, on scan, if the fetal parts are identified at that like either in the scan or you are doing abortion and you are able to find fetal parts, then no need for any kind of follow-up. But if the medical abortion is done, usually patient will pass out tissue in the home. So you don't know what has come out. So you have to follow this patient. So you will do it at after 3 weeks. Okay. And incidence of therapeutic abortion, GTN in therapeutic abortion, incidence is 1 in 20,000. So if 20,000 abortions are done, only one case of GTN will be there.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yes, only, but I am asking about spontaneous miscarriage, not a medical or surgical.
Then in that situation, it will come in this heading. No tissue is sent for histopathology. Do UPT after 3 weeks?
Yes. Okay.
Okay, so this also about the topic pregnancy they have added. So usually after ectopic pregnancy, if the HCG is persistently high, okay, and or if after the two treatments for methotrexate has been done, and if it is still high, so this patient has to be referred to GTD center. And in this type of patient cases, sometimes histopathology will be there. Or if the medical treatment is done for like ectopic pregnancy and two times they have given methotrexate and it is failed, then there will be no histopathology with you or with the treating doctor. So in both of the situation, patient has to be referred to GTD center. Okay, so in ectopic pregnancy there are two indications. If persistently high HCG, so this is number one. Number two, after two medical treatment of with the methotrexate, it is high. Then also, these are the two indication in ectopic pregnancy, you will send this patient to GTD center. Okay, what they are saying that low levels of HCG may be there. And if the low levels of HCG elevation is there, so you either what could be the possibilities? So now you can tell me low level of HCG elevation is associated with what conditions? You may get question from there.
Low level may be associated with malignant female germ cell tumors or any epithelial cancers, including bladder, breast, lung, gastric and colorectal cancers.
Yes, so this
and it will be also caused by presence of pituitary HCG or the presence of human antibodies.
Okay, so you will get question from here. So what are the cancers where low level of HCG rise can be there? So you have to remember this. Okay, that malignant germ cell tumor everybody knows. Just remember this epithelial cancer. So bladder, breast, lung, gastric and colorectal. Okay, apart from this, what is the HCG? Whether it is a what kind of what is the structure of HCG?
It's a glycoprotein.
Yes, you have to remember this because there is a question where HCG is a glycoprotein. Okay, what the people do mistake, they mark HCG as steroid. Okay, this is a common mistake. HCG has got many subtypes. It will be free beta intact HCG. It will be free beta HCG. it will be nicked HCG or it will be core fragment. So a number of variants are there. What are the routine assays we are sending for HCG? So they will not check for all variants. Only all variants are checked in 3 UK GTD center. Therefore, all the follow-up is done here. Okay, now there is a healthy pregnancy, and after a healthy pregnancy, either abortion has been done or delivery has been done. So patient is bleeding irregularly or persistently. So for after how many weeks you will suspect that there could be some issues with mole? Bleeding for how many weeks after pregnancy event? You will think of it.
Eight weeks, ma'am. 8 weeks.
Yes. For any pregnancy event, if there had been an irregular bleeding for 8 weeks, then you will think of this molar pregnancy, and UPT has to be done. Okay, so this is newly added in this guideline. Now you see the recommendation for miscarriage follow-up, for abortion follow-up, and for pregnancy event follow-up. Every time it is different, and you have to remember this because you will get question from every different part. Okay, so for pregnancy it is, so I can repeat it everything again. For miscarriage, they are sending tissues for histopathology, and if histopathology is not done, so they will do UPT after 3 weeks. This is the recommendation for miscarriage. For abortion, if the fetal parts are identified, no need for histopathology. But if fetal parts are not identified or medical abortion is done, consideration for urine pregnancy test should be done after 3 weeks. Now this is for the abortion. Now for normal pregnancy event, okay, so if the pregnancy event has happened, then after 8 weeks, if bleeding is not settled, then consideration for urine pregnancy test or UP or HCG test has to be done. So these are the 3 different situations you have to understand, then only the answer you'll be able to put. Okay, sometime there will be a varied presentation, dyspnea, if the lung involvement is there, hemoptysis, dyspnea, paralysis, it could be there. And if the brain metastasis is there, then there could be seizures and paralysis. Fine. Now if the secondary deposits on the vagina is there, so what do you think, biopsy should be done or not for diagnosis from vaginal bluish spot secondary deposits? You will take
not
biopsy
recommended.
Yes,
biopsy not so, recommended.
Yes, you will get this question also.
Refuse hemorrhage.
Yes, because if the bleeding starts from your biopsy site, you won't be able to control it. So avoid
do
taking
increase
biopsy.
The volume.
Anyone asking anything? Okay, so you can get this as a question also. So if any secondary deposits or bluish nodule you are finding, you have got a suspicion, okay, it could be the secondary, please don't ever take any biopsy for diagnosis, because there will be heavy bleeding and you won't be able to control it. Okay, so this part we have discussed. Okay, this part also we have ectopic pregnancy. What they are saying for the ectopic also, they send after they take out a tissue, they send it for histopathology. If they confirm it as a molar pregnancy, so in that particular situation, it has to be sent expertise for his pathological review. Okay, so if the local tissue diagnosis now in your hospital, ectopic was done and you have sent this for histopathology and you have got a suspicion for molar ectopic pregnancy, then for further review you will send this to center. Okay, so you may get question from there, this also as a scenario, that ectopic was done, it has come as molar pregnancy, what will be the next step? Your answer will be advice, it should be sent to a center for expertise advice for pathological review. Okay, so this part is also newly added in this guideline. Now you are there are so the twin now the twin pregnancy has come. So in the twin pregnancy and mole, okay. So there will be two referrals. In the UK, they have got fetal medicine center. So this patient will be referred to fetal medicine center regional and also GTD center, because now the two things are there. And in this patients, what can happen? These numbers I have already explained. So early fetal loss could be 40%, premature birth 36%, preeclampsia will be 20%. Okay, so these three things are important. Now you may get question from this part, okay? Like a pre-invasive testing for fetal karyotype. If the diagnosis is not clear, okay, in that like whether it is a complete mole or whether it is along with the coexisting normal twin, or it is a partial mole. So consideration for amniocentesis or pre-invasive testing for karyotype can be done. Okay, so this is one of the indication for fetal karyotype. You will get question from here also. And if any time they have got any suspicion that some problem will be there with the placenta, like on the ultrasound scan, or if they suspect mesenchymal hyperplasia, then also like it is an abnormal placenta, so consideration for fetal karyotype can be done. So these are the two indications in case of abnormal placenta where consideration for fetal karyotype can be done. Okay, is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry to interrupt, ma'am. Hello.
Yes.
Hello. It is the invasive testing only, now, ma'am. The fetal karyotyping is only the invasive, through invasive only, no?
Yes, with the immunocentesis. It is immunocentesis. Yeah.
Okay.
They will take that amniotic fluid and they will do karyotype. So that is invasive.
Okay.
That is needed. Invasive technique.
Okay.
About this PSTT and ETT. So this part I have already discussed. So usually they have got different presentation. They are less predictable. So usually they don't respond to chemotherapy. So hysterectomy will be then an option. Okay, in this kind of tumors, PSTT and ETT. Now this is about atypical. There is placental site nodule. And there is atypical placental site nodule. So for typical placental site nodule, no further investigation is required. But why we are worried? We are worried about atypical placental nodule. This will call for central follow-up for discussion. Why? Because in 10 to 15% people with an atypical placental nodule, there could be possibility of cancer. Okay, this part, this number I have put in the slide also. Okay, so this much you have to know about atypical placental nodule. And if it is there, so treatment will be hysterectomy. But if the patient requires more children, then further treatment and would be done. Further testing, like whether a pre-existing cancer is there, and treatment will be done after counseling. So this much knowledge about atypical placental nodule you have to know. Okay, so these are the indications where registration will be done. So you have to, so now Zunaitha, you can tell me what are the indication where patient should be registered and followed up with a screening center.
For complete molar pregnancy and partial molar pregnancy, in twin pregnancy with complete or partial molar pregnancy, and then with macroscopic or microscopic molar change, suggesting early complete or partial molar pregnancy or choriocarcinoma, and placental site trophoblastic tumor or the epithelial trophoblastic tumor, and atypical placental site nodule.
Okay, so this this you have to remember. Yeah, you will find this in the question also. So the important, everything you will remember, just don't forget this atypical placental site nodule, because you may forget this putting in this list.
Ma'am, one doubt, ma'am. Ma'am, these they we need to refer to screening center means that three centers, ma'am, that Sheffield, London, and or there will be localized center, ma'am.
No, only in UK there are three centers, Sheffield and one in Dundee and one I don't remember that. So there are three hospitals only in whole UK. Whenever any HMOL is coming, so there will be registration with all these three centers only. Okay, so follow up and treatment is done by these only.
Ma'am, that center is called the regional center or the local centers, what they call these three centers, because in the questions they are giving as the regional centers, local screening centers, like that they are giving, ma'am. So which one to choose, regional centers? Is it the regional? Because they're not particularly giving that the screening centers there, like that they are not giving, ma'am. The question they are giving at the regional center or the local centers, like that the options are there. So we are asking, ma'am.
Okay, I will give you answer. You will understand. So see, for GTD center only three center. So if GTD is coming in the question, you will always find only GTD center. But local and regional centers are there in few specialties like fetal medicine unit, urogyne, and many other also. So they have got a regional center also or local center also. So if you are getting questions from fetal medicine referral or from urogyne, so you will find local and regional. Okay, for GTD such kind of word you will not find. You will because only three centers are there. Am I clear?
Yes, yes, ma'am. Got it. Might be the question framing might be something different in that book, ma'am.
Okay, so you just understand this. Your answer will be, you know, you have to understand the basic thing, what they want. Then the answer will be okay. Because for GTD, only three centers.
Yeah, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, this part I have already done. So now you can again sum up in what will be the follow for complete molar pregnancy.
For complete molar pregnancy, if the HCG has reverted back to normal within 56 days of pregnancy, then follow up will be for 6 months from the date of evacuation, ma'am.
Okay. Second,
if the HCG has not reverted to normal within 56 days of pregnancy, then follow up will be from 6 months of normalization of the HCG.
Okay, yeah. So this is for
HCG
the complete
will be two weekly HCG till normalization, ma'am.
Yes. So this is for the complete mole, and you will get question from there. So there is no change in that. So change is here in partial mole. So how what will be the follow for partial mole?
In partial mole, follow-up will be concluded once the HCG has returned to normal on two samples and at least 4 weeks apart, ma'am.
Okay, so once it has come back as normal, so two sample 4 weeks apart has to be done. And if they also come as normal, then patient will be out from follow-up. Okay, so this part I have already explained. So if the patient, this is new in this guideline, if the patient has not received any chemotherapy, so in future pregnancy event, no longer HCG has to be measured. Okay, this is new in this guideline. And this is why? Because in subsequent pregnancy, incidence of GTD is only 1 in 4,000. So it is very low. Why to screen so many pregnancies? So they have removed that option in this guideline.
This means that after 8 weeks after delivery, we do HCG. That one remains, ma'am.
No. Okay. So, okay, you are getting confused. Actually, there are two different things you have to understand. So, in previous guideline, what they said, if any time, like a patient has been diagnosed with a molar pregnancy, her follow-up is complete. she becomes pregnant one time, two time, three time, or four time. Every time they will do follow up with HCG to just pick up any recurrence. Okay, this was there in the previous guideline, but in this new guideline, if a patient has not received any kind of chemotherapy, then whenever she gets pregnant in future, whatever will be the number of pregnancy, routine follow up for HCG will not be done. So it is saying in new this guideline. Okay, this I was explaining. What you are saying is what they written in the guideline. Now any patient, they have got any pregnancy event, but it is not mole pregnancy. Maybe it is a normal pregnancy or anything, but a patient is coming to you saying, doctor, I'm bleeding, and bleeding is irregular and persistent. And after pregnancy event, if she is bleeding for 8 weeks, then you will do UPT to just rule out whether there had been any possibility of molar pregnancy. That is completely different scenario. Is the thing clear?
No, ma'am, actually, in previous guideline, it was given after any event of molar pregnancy. In one pregnancy, it is molar, then we need to follow every pregnancy 6 to 8 weeks after delivery, we need to do HCG.
But now they have removed that.
Now they removed, and they told only if a patient underwent undergone chemotherapy, that time we need to do.
Yes.
Is correct, ma'am?
If they, yes. If they don't require any chemotherapy treatment, then in future pregnancy event, no follow-up is required.
Madam,
okay.
If it is the miscarriage, then we have to send them.
Please repeat your question.
If it is the miscarriage, we have to send the histological tissue has to be sent for the histological review.
Yes.
After the molar, if it is the miscarriage, we have to send. If it is the pregnancy, no need to send. Is it so, ma'am?
No, you are getting confused. Please repeat your question.
Oh. No, Madhu, it is after every miscarriage, we have to send some tissues.
No, it's
not like that, I think. Yeah, I'm asking because in the previous guideline, it is given that any subsequent, whatever pregnancy event, we have to test for the HCG. But now...
Yes.
They're telling that subsequent pregnancy event, there is no need to send if they don't receive the chemotherapy. But
yes.
I'm asking, ma'am, if previously they wrote as the any miscarriage, any surgical or the medical, some tissue has to be sent. If the no fetal part has been seen, then we have to send for the HPE. But if the fetal part is there, no need to send. So what is the... I'm confused in between these two, ma'am.
Okay, so there are two different things. So right now we are doing is follow up future about the future follow up. Okay, and what you are saying is the current pregnancy treatment. I have repeated this
if it happened after the molar pregnancy. Again, the miscarriage happened. We have to follow as the miscarriage, the miscarriage part, ma'am.
Okay,
that's
so
what I'm confused, ma'am.
Okay, if today if the miscarriage is there and you have sent for histopathology, and if it is come as molar pregnancy, okay, then if this you will put this patient on follow up, but if you are not giving any kind of chemotherapy. So in future, any kind of pregnancy event, you will not follow this patient. Now the thing's clear.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Got it, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah. Now this you have to the PSTT and ETT, they are treated by surgery because they are less sensitive to chemotherapy. This part I have already told you. Now this you have to remember. Why you have to remember this? Because you will get questions from there. Okay. So and this number, the few numbers are important. So if the score is less than 6, so cure rate will be 100%. If the score is less than more than 7, so it is 94%. Both numbers are important to remember. This part I have already told. If the score is more than 13, then there will be risk of death is there within 4 weeks. Okay. So if, because it is so high score, okay, this is newly added in this guideline. Now about the PSCT and ETT. So incidence is 0.2%. They have got a lymphatic spread. They are chemo resistant. So now understand, because, and also they don't produce more amount of HCG. So these kind of tumors, they are generally not managed according to FIGO, because in FIGO, one of the criteria is HCG levels. Okay. But in these tumors, PSTT and ETT, they are producing very less HCG. So they are not managed according to FIGO. Okay. So if usually treatment for this kind of tumor, it will be surgery. Surgery is a major, plays a major important role in the management of PSCT and ETT. And if chemotherapy has to be given, so it is platinum-based chemotherapy. It is not EMACO, what it is given as a multi-agent chemotherapy in molar pregnancy. So for PSCT and ETT, it is platinum-based chemotherapy. So treatment of choice will be surgery. Hysterectomy is the mainstay of treatment. But if spread disease is there, consideration for platinum-based chemotherapy. Okay, this part you have to understand. And if multiple relapses are there after chemotherapy, then consideration for stem cell recovery, treatment for immunotherapy has been approved by NHS for GTN. So if you may get scenario, patient had PSTT or ETT, and that is a multiple treatment has been are there and relapse is there. So and patient was treated with high dose chemotherapy. So what could be the options would be there, other options. So chemotherapy, you can put chemotherapy with stem cell recovery or treatment with immunotherapy. So usually this kind of treatment, they don't offer, chemotherapy, this immunotherapy in stem cell recovery, but it is approved by NHS in GTN cases, okay, with PSTT and ETT. So this is a new thing that you have to know. Okay, so how long patient has to wait for conceiving?
Until the follow-up is complete, women advised not to conceive.
Yes.
And if the for undergoing chemotherapy, they should, yeah, they are advised not to conceive for at least 1 year after completion of treatment.
Yes. Okay. So this is fine. Now, what is the what is the risk of molar pregnancy recurrence?
1%, ma'am.
It is 1%. Now, if the patient has a molar pregnancy and the patient again became pregnant, so what will be the increased risk?
Increased risk means previous two molars, ma'am, you mean?
No. If the patient had a molar pregnancy, she took treatment, now she again become pregnant. Okay, so what is the more important risk in subsequent pregnancy? So it is 25% increase. Yes, this part you have to remember. Okay, what they are saying, if the patient is taking chemotherapy, so teratogenicity concerns are there if patient conceives within 12 months. Okay, therefore they want to wait them for 12 months. and congenital abnormality rate, irrespective of any kind of treatment, it is 1.8%. This I have put in the slide also. So how many future pregnancy can happen in a patient who has taken chemotherapy?
80%, ma'am.
80%. This is a new number. This you have to remember. Okay, so there is a risk of premature menopause. So if the patient is approaching 40, so they have to be warned about negative impact on the fertility. Okay. Now, if the chemotherapy is given, so secondary cancers are there. Like in previous guideline, they have mentioned the name of those secondary cancers, but in this guideline, they have not mentioned it. Okay. So because risk of secondary cancers because of the chemotherapy is there, but it is very low.
Okay, ma'am, so there was one word regarding menopause, ma'am. That is because of if single agent used, there will be 1 year. And multi-agent that is not here, ma'am.
No, this guideline, it is not there. They have not mentioned that.
Okay, ma'am.
In this guideline, only they said there are increased risk of premature menopause. When the patient is treated with combination therapy, they are not saying anything about single agent. It is about the multiple agent only. Okay, but they have not mentioned that year.
Okay, ma'am.
Now this FSRH, what they are saying. So this part I have already showed you. Now, if the patient wants to take fertility drug or any kind of estrogen, so when it can be given?
Once the HCG levels become normal, we can use estrogens, ma'am.
Yes. So any estrogen or any fertility drug or any HRT can be given if the HCG comes back to normal. Okay. So now they have got to support the people. They have got GTD nurses, advisors, GTD center. They can be contacted on the phone or online support groups are there. And these are three. No, you will not get question from there. And these are the three centers. Okay. So one is the this Charing Cross Hospital, another one is the Sheffield, another is the it is in the Nine Wells Hospital, Dundee. But nobody is asking you name of this. So only three centers are there. There is no like regional or local thing is there in GTD. Only GTD treatment center. Your question will come as that this way only. Okay, so that's all about guideline. If anyone has got any question to ask you, so you can ask. Any question?
Ma'am, that regarding contraception, we can use DMPA also, no, ma'am?
Yeah, use. I have already shown the same slide in front of you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That time, when we can start, ma'am?
So what they are saying, if it is decreasing, if they are undetectable, and if they are elevated, in all condition, DMPA will be category 1. Okay, so you have to remember these categories because when you are putting answers, so sometimes it causes confusion. How in the high level we can give DMPA? But we have to go answer according to their guidelines. And you can see for implant, for DMPA, for POP, everything is category 1. And only this criteria 3 and 4 are there for intrauterine. So if decreasing HCG levels, it is category 3 for intrauterine device. And if it is rising, then or elevated, then it is category 4. Rest, everything is category 1.
I am asking, can we give the DMPA immediately after suction evacuation?
Yes, according to this, you can. According to this, it can be given. Is it clear?
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Okay, so that's all about Ashmol. Anyone has got any question? So it is everything I covered, GTD, GTN, new guideline, and also a strategy thing. Any question? Okay, sir. So someone has asked question, post-molar follow-up, please explain again. So in case of complete mole, follow-up, if it becomes, if the SCG level, they come back to normal within 56 days. So it has to be done for 6 months from the day of removal of pregnancy. Second, if it does not come normal within 56 days, it takes longer. Then follow-up has to be done for 6 months from the date where HCG has become normal. So this is the follow-up pattern for complete mole. For partial mole, there had been a change. So for partial mole, what they are saying, when the HCG level come back to normal, so usually they will do two HCG level 4 weeks apart, and if they are normal, then a follow up for partial mole will be completed. Okay, so when till it comes normal, according to protocol, what they follow, it is done 2 times a week. But once it becomes normal, then it is usually done weekly. I think I have answered your question.
Regarding okay. Concept.
Yes.
Yeah, for chemotherapy, for those patients underwent chemotherapy, those okay, not so undergoing chemotherapy, how long we advise, ma'am?
Okay, so for chemotherapy, okay, that details I have not put because, you know, usually they are not asked. But if the patient is taking chemotherapy, so in that situation, once it becomes normal, then for 6 more cycles, they have to give. Okay.
No, ma'am. I am asking pregnancy, ma'am. Pregnancy, it is after 1 year if patient is taking chemotherapy. If not taking chemotherapy, how long they have to wait? 6 months?
Yes. Then it will be complete mole or partial mole. So follow will be same what I already explained.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Okay, so these are the questions you can answer.
It need multi-agent, ma'am. Imaco.
Yes. Answer is Imaco. Why? Now you have to calculate this scoring. So she is 40, more than 40. So score, she got score 1. Term pregnancy, because it is term pregnancy. So that is score 2. And they have got 8 nodules. Okay, 8 nodules are there, more than 8. So it is, yes.
Sorry, ma'am. It is the 8 nodules, but it is in the lung, na, ma'am. Lung is 0.
5 centimeter lesion.
That is different. That is different.
That is so different.
Number of metastases is different entity. Site is different entity.
I want to clarify, please.
Okay, so this
ma'am,
is the
I'm having this doubt because someone gave the someone told that some other mentor ma'am, they told that when the nodules are in the lung, it gives as a 0. Whatever the number of the nodules are there, it will come as the, if it is in the lung, it will come as a 0. That's why I'm asking, ma'am.
Okay, like here, they have not mentioned size. Okay. Okay, you have to just understand. if the size of like where the metastases are present, if they are asking about metastases in a lung, then it will be zero. But if they they are giving number of metastases irrespective of any site, then this numbering has to be done according to this number of metastases. So it is different for site and it is different for number. Now the is it clear?
Yes ma'am. If it is size, it is zero. Number means we have to count it.
Yes. So it 8 nodules more than 4, so total is more than 7. Okay, more than 6, it is 7. So if it is 7, it has to be multiple.
One single agent, ma'am, score will be less than 6.
Yes. So she is more than 40. She got score 1. HCG is also 1000. So 1000 is 1. Okay. So a 2 centimeter lesion is there. So 2 centimeter lesion is 0. So less than 6. So answer will be single agent. This answer will also come from scoring.
Metastasis to the brain.
Yes.
Score of 4.
So that will give score of 4.
Diaspermic fertilization, ma'am.
B.
Yes, which one? This one.
Diaspermic fertilization of an ovum. But in recent guideline, in complete also diaspermic fertilization is there, no?
No, but diffuse villus for hydrops will not be there in a partial mold.
Okay, so
it is focal, okay, so it cannot be the answer. So answer will be this only. And in diaspermic, in complete mole is only 20-25%.
20%, okay ma'am, 20%.
Yeah, in partial, it is 90%.
Ma'am, it is partial mole.
Yes, it is partial mole.
So there will be triploid karyotype. Answer should be C.
Triploid, all cases have triploid.
All are not triploid.
Okay, 90%
is triploid.
10%
is tetraploid. Tetraploid also.
Okay, so this cannot be answer. So answer is diaspermic fertilization.
Histological diagnosis of complete hydratiform mole
is
not an indication.
Yes.
Any advice not to conceive after 1 year?
Yes, very simple answer. So they should not advise to conceive after 1 year.
HRT is safe only now, ma'am.
HRT once level has come back to normal.
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, we read.
follow-up of 6 months from normalization of the HCG, because HCG not returned back to normal in 56 days.
Yes, so answer will be this only. Yes, your answer is right. So therefore calculation, now if you calculate 8 weeks, 8 into 7, 56.
She can continue the OCP, oral contraception, and she should be advised that there is potential but low increased risk of developing GTN.
So what will be the answer?
Last one.
Yes, last is the answer. Because barrier methods are preferred and these are not contraindicated. IUCD are not safe. These are category 3 and 4. Oral COP contraceptives are not stopped. So this is the answer.
Suction curettage is the method of choice of evacuation for complete molar pregnancies. C.
C.
Yeah, ma'am. 40% proceed to deliver healthy babies.
Yes.
Yes, yeah, madam.
A single yeah, so agent.
Somebody, yeah, so yeah, some yeah. Someone was asking this: what is how the chemotherapy is done? So it is methotrexate and folinic acid. Usually they are given intermittently. Okay, so day 1, 3, 5, 7, it will be methotrexate. And day 2, 4, 6, 8, it will be folinic acid. Then there will be a rest. Okay. After that, after the rest, it will continue. And this will continue till HCG has come normal. And when HCG has come normal, then also 6 treatments more for 6 further consecutive weeks will more be required. So someone was asking details of chemotherapy. So this is the detail. Okay, this is the, these are the options. This is the question. These are the options.
Ma'am, question, ma'am. Options, ma'am. Answer C, ma'am. Methotrexate with folinic acid.
Yes, because she is less than 40.
she's coming within 3 months, and only 3 nodules are there. So it is less than 6. So it will be folic acid and intramuscular methotrexate and folic acid.
Yeah, ma'am. 16 cities. So medical termination of pregnancy.
What is the answer?
Yeah, medical termination.
Yes, it is a partial molar pregnancy, 16 weeks. So you have to do it medically.
Suction evacuation, ma'am.
Yes, because here the patient is coming with a compromise. So you have to do it. Otherwise, she will die. So the answer will be suction evacuation.
Ma'am, in the last question, if the option of the oxytocin is also given, then can we use that because it is very heavy bleeding?
No,
along with the suction, no, ma'am.
No, because okay. You know,
because if the potential hemorrhage is there, then we can choose the oxytocin, no, ma'am. If it suction, yeah, along with the suction,
if they give that kind of option, oxytocin after balancing risk of tumor embolization and suction evacuation, then you can put this answer.
Okay.
If they have okay, not given okay. That, suction evacuation will be the answer.
Okay.
So what will be the answer?
Methotrexate, ma'am.
No, why? See the beta HCG level.
Okay, ma'am. Multi-agent.
Yes, answer.
Multi-agent. Sorry.
This kind of question usually you will get in the exam. So it is a weird, what we are doing is an EMQ because the options are same. These are the options.
Pre-invasive fetal karyotyping.
Karyotyping.
Yes.
Natal invasive.
Fetal karyotype is the answer.
It needs fetal medicine referrals, ma'am.
Yes, because karyotype is done in fetal medicine, people will be doing okay.
Okay, ma'am.
These are the options.
Question, please. Options, ma'am. M madam. Suction evacuation.
So if histology confirm fetal plot and parts and normal trophoblast. Okay, normal trophoblast with the areas of molar degeneration.
The small fetus, why can't we do surgical? And anti-D prophylaxis also has to be given.
Oh ma'am, rest and treatment not required.
Yes, answer is test and treatment not required. But how come it is O?
It is partial molluloma.
Because normal trophoblast. Trophoblasts are normal. Trophoblastic hyperplasia is not there.
But with areas of molar degeneration, mean it is partial mole or not?
Yeah, it appears
already to be. evacuation done, ma'am. So might be Rh negative, but it is anti-D is required.
Yes, Madhu, correct.
Anti-D is required, but evacuation is done, but both is confusing.
More confused when they have done it. Pelvic ultrasound shows
after
small
an evacuation, ma'am. And the last sentence is given that after an evacuation of the uterus, histology confirms the fetal parts and normal trophoblast. So evacuation is done, but only thing is anti-D has to be given.
Anti-D, like it they might have given histology comes late. Usually they has to NTD has to be given in 72
but partial
hours.
Mole, yeah, partial mole we have to give the NTD.
NTD has to be given. Okay, so according to the answer they gave, if it is what they are saying, because trophoblastic hyperplasia is not there, so what answer is no test and treatment required. They're
actually
not considering
this is unrecognized GTD. Correct, ma'am. In ultrasound, it is not diagnosed. It is diagnosed only in histology.
In histology, also, you know, the trophoblasts are normal. Trophoblastic okay, hyperplasia is not there. That is trophoblastic hyperplasia, hydropic changes. These are the pathology findings for mole, and that is not there. So this creates, you know, confusion. But this is the answer and question answer from strategy. Okay, that so like this is the answer they gave. But it is confusing because according to them, fetal parts are there and trophoblasts are normal. That means it is a normal pregnancy. Fine. But this word areas of molar degeneration is confusing.
Can't it require the anti-D, ma'am? In this case, anti-D is required, ma'am. How can we no treatment is not required?
Anti-D, okay. So anti-D they have given after evacuation is done, within 72 hours. Histopathology is, it takes late, so it has come like already.
Okay, already we have to assume that it was done. Okay.
Yeah,
it might have done already.
Yeah. Okay.
Usually it will come after 2 weeks or like that. So that
okay,
they are asking okay.
Yes.
Okay. It is
ma'am,
not about
any.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
In this, what would be the appropriate answer, ma'am? It might be a partial mole. No, that time we need follow up till HCG becomes normal. Is it correct, ma'am?
Yes, it is correct. But you know, in a partial mole, usually what will be the in histopathology, it will be focal trophoblastic hyperplasia, it will be a focal hydropic changes in trophoblast, and it will be trophoblastic inclusions. So these are the characteristic features for partial mole, but they have written normal trophoblast. Okay, so trophoblast, there is no hyperplasia, nothing is there. So it is considered as a normal thing. only some degeneration is there, molar degeneration, but trophoblasts are normal. Therefore, they are considering this report as a normal report. Okay. That is my explanation. Yeah, that way only I can explain, though they have not, you know, given any explanation, and answer is from RCOG only. Okay, with this, if any one of you have got any